It is a wonderful morning here. January 3rd, 2020. We're about 3 days away from a real historically pivotal day, January 6th. It's a very dangerous moment in history, to say the least. What we have to do is we have to get ahead of this. Kind of like the Shea Stadium Beatles concert in 65. That was an extremely dangerous moment in history. And unfortunately, a lot of us weren't able to get ahead of that. I was back then studying Ram Maharshi when I was a kid. I was like, 9 years old. I was studying the spiritual, I'm trying to get my spiritual focus, for my life. And then this, Beatlemania hits, is on television, the Ed Sullivan Show. All the people come to school the next morning and they've all gone crazy, and I didn't know what was going on and didn't know that the Beatles, didn't know about amphetamines, that the Beatles were popping amphetamines like vitamin pills. And that gave them this feeling that they've got love all figured out. Don't worry, we've got it all figured out. We've got everything figured out, Just follow us. And of course, it didn't end up well. Back in 1970, they've broken up. And the time between 65 and 70, they were going through disintegration, and inner band, conflicts of all types. And didn't end well at all, actually. So we got dragged through that muck because we thought, the Beatles, a lot of people believe the Beatles had it all figured out. And whereas in previously they didn't have love figured out, that was the problem. But now we have love figured out. You see, so it was a bridge between the God-centric false hope belief system and the goddess-centric false hope belief system. And what they were saying to get people to bridge and buy into it, was that the problem was in the past. That the God-centric false hope belief system didn't have love figured out. But now we've got love all figured out. Don't worry. Well, that's exactly how amphetamines make you feel. It was the drugs talking through the Beatles and through many, many, many others, actually. British invasion was fueled by drugs, amphetamines, a combination of amphetamines and barbiturates, too, so they could keep taking the amphetamines without getting too burned out. And it was the drugs talking. And the drugs, amphetamine is the most dangerous drug there is. And amphetamine makes you feel like you've got it all figured out. You got love all figured out. Don't worry, folks. Pied Piper, follow me. So people then that caused this massive youth wave that did follow that. And what was being smuggled in underneath that smokescreen? Well, female supremacy was. They call it feminism, which is just a euphemism for female supremacy and goddess-centric false hope belief system. In order to keep hope alive, make false hope great again, has been taking place for, the last 100 years, actually. The transition from a God-centric false hope belief system to a goddess-centric false hope belief system has been going on for about 100 years now, at least. Okay. And the second wave hit in the 60s, where the Beatles, second wave of quote-unquote feminism, female supremacy, hit in the 60s. And the Beatles were the vehicle that they used. Okay, that the goddess used the goddess-centric false hope belief system, used the Beatles. And what does the goddess-centric false hope system use? Predominantly drugs. Drugs, 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 drugs. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. That's the goddess. And see, the God-centric belief system, false hope belief system, doesn't allow that. It says, no, that's not good. That's not good for you. So that's what the Beatles are all about, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And so they use the drugs and let the drugs do the talking. And the drugs, of course, make you feel like, we got love all figured out. Don't worry. This is going to make you happy. Before, we didn't have it figured out, but now we do. Okay. Got electronics, too. So on that wave, female supremacy was smuggled in under that smokescreen. And now we're at a point, of course, where it's going to assert its absolute domination, goddess-centric beliefs, false hope belief system, and crush, the previous false hope belief system. That's its purpose right now. Very interesting. How do you get ahead of all of this? How do you get ahead of this so you don't get entangled in it, you see, or have to slam on the brakes and just become subservient to it all? So this is what we're working on here. Again, all false hope systems are equally false. Okay, they're all equally false. The idea that the screen of reality we call God the Father or the Prime Creator, that's like the screen upon which appearances appear, experiencing appears. The idea that that's incapacitated is a false premise. Once we accept a false premise, then we have to generate false hope that this premise is true and we can find a cure for the problem. We can find a cure for the problem. We believe that the screen is damaged, so we have to fix it. Well, how do we fix it? Love will fix it, is what the goddess-centric tells everyone. Don't worry, we got this all figured out. It's all about love, is what they'll say. There isn't any fixing of the screen. The screen's always been perfect. So no matter how you say that this is how we fix it, that's false hope. That doesn't work. So the real spiritual teachers, the great coaches, they know how to go about it. Ram Maharshi is one of those. So Ram Maharshi gave me some insight this morning. I've kind of been like, hey, Ramana, you need both the screen and the appearancing on the screen is two in one. You have to have both. If you have a screen with no appearancing on it, you don't really have a screen. It's meaningless because screen is a functional term. If there's no appearancing on a screen, how is the screen functioning as a screen? It's not. That's why Jesus said that it's God the Father, God the Son. And then God the Holy Spirit is a blessing of that. Once God the Son took this false premise. But originally you have God the Father, God the Son. In other words, the screen isn't functioning as a screen unless there's appearancing, creative appearancing arising on the screen. So God the Son is this creative appearancing. God the Father is this self-luminous screen that enables all appearancing to take place and induces it, actually. But the screen is prior to appearancing. It's impossible to have appearancing without a screen. But you can have a screen without appearancing. It's just not meaningful. But first you have to have a screen in order for then appearancing to actually appear. So God the Father is primary first, and God the Son is secondary. It's an appearancing on this screen that's induced. The screen induces the appearancing. Without any screen, there would be no inducement of appearancing, actually. So without God the Father, God the Prime Creator, there would be no inducement of God the Son, the creative play of appearances on the screen, experiencing on the screen. So what Ram Maharshi said this morning, I read a quote I've never heard before, which really, to me, indicates he gets it. He totally gets it. He says the problem is you've been focusing on the appearancing, completely ignoring the screen like it doesn't exist, that somehow appearancing can be prior to the screen. Or what I figured out last night was this tremendous breakthrough of what we really did, what Spirit really did. And I can explain this at some point. If it's very explainable in general. The details have to be worked out. But we have enough foresight about this now that hindsight can fill in the details for us. So we're ahead of the situation right now, what's coming in the world. So I've been really anxious, almost unprecedentedly agitated and anxious. But this is starting to now lessen. It's starting to lessen because I see Ram Maharshi. His thing is just be the screen, focused on the screen. Don't worry about the appearancing. And I said, I always say, well, Ramana, a screen without appearancing is not really a screen. But he indicated with a quote that I just read, what he's really saying, look, you've got to get back to recognizing the screen comes first. It's primary. Instead, we have been insisting that appearancing came first. And since when we insist that appearancing comes first without the screen, what happens is we don't have any appearancing. But what we really did, is we tried to have no experiencing on the screen, try to stifle all experiencing, so then we didn't experience anything. The experience of not experiencing, you might call it, okay. And then we claimed, you know, that that we said, well, we're prior, you know, well, what we did is then we said, hey, God, you know, you don't exist. The screen isn't there. We're aware, but the screen isn't there. We said, well, if there's no experiencing, that means the screen isn't there. That means we're prior to the screen. We're prior to the screen, you see? If we're aware, but we're not experiencing, we say, well, there must be no screen. But what we did is we took the idea of no experiencing, and that was what was actually being reflected on the screen, except we said, well, there's no screen there because there's no appearancing, no experiencing, get it? And then God said, no, the screen is there. It's still there perfectly. And then we said, no. He said, no. He said, well, if you're the, then we said, okay. We said, well, okay, God, if the screen is there, as you insist, we'll say, okay. However, that must mean the screen is defective. Because we were trying to experience something and we didn't get it. And God says, no, you were experiencing no experience in order to claim the screen wasn't there. So this is how spirit is being dishonest here with God, trying to fool God, the prime creator, by saying, well, no experiencing means there's no screen. And God says, no, the screen's still there. You just chose the idea of no experiencing to try to make it seem like there was no screen. But then we doubled down and said, well, okay, if there is a screen, it must be defective because it's not reflecting my experiencing to me. It's not reflecting. So it's a defective screen. Therefore, we have to fix this defective screen. We have to fix this defective screen. And the way that we've gone about this is to imagine defective screenness, where we are imagining that our experiencing, the desire for experiencing, is not being reflected properly to us. It's being reflected in a distorted manner. Sickness, aging, decline, incapacitation, vulnerability, all this stuff. This symbolically represents a defective screen. And then we're trying to use, quote unquote, love to make ourselves happy. Love, sex, drugs, rock and roll. To make us happy, happy humans, so to speak. And then we'll say, that's healing the screen. Healing the screen. We're trying to heal the screen of God, the prime creator, claiming the screen became incapacitated, which is why we weren't getting our experiencing. But keep in mind, we chose the experience of no experiencing in order so that we could then claim the screen was defective, you see? So this has all become clear now. It's all become clear. And then the details will fit in, and you know, hindsight will show us the details. We don't want to lose sight of the basic mechanic, basic outline, by wandering into a forest of trees, you know, like me going into too many details. We don't need to go into all those details at this point. What we want is to get the basics. We pulled this con job, so to speak. We wanted to be prior to reality, but there's a problem, you know. We realized no screen, no experiencing. So we then took the idea of no experiencing means no screen. It means the idea of no experiencing means no screen. It doesn't. It just means no experiencing is being reflected by the screen, so to speak. The screen's still there. It's still perfectly functional. But then we claim, well, no, if it is there, it's not reflecting properly at all. The idea of no experiencing feels like there's nothing being reflected, but it is actually reflecting no experiencing to us. Okay, this is the key element here. What we said, no, God, it means that the screen's defective. It's incapacitated. We have to fix it. In other words, this is still playing the game like we're prior to you and we're capable of fixing the screen, you know, that kind of thing. So we're in this hypothetical simulation of imaginary decline and incapacitation, symbolizing an incapacitated screen. That which makes experiencing experienceable for us. Call it pure awareness, pure consciousness, etc. So the spiritual coaches always tell us to focus on pure awareness, pure consciousness. I am the screen. I am that, just the screen. And not the appearancing. Don't focus on that at all. So this is a technique. This is a technique, actually. This is what Ramaharshi is indicating. He says you're totally ignoring the screen and focusing just on the appearancing. It's this game you're playing. And I say, ah. So he's saying just, you know, cut out the mind entirely, stop the mind. And stop this game. You're able to get free of this game by realizing the screen is perfect. We don't have to fix or heal the screen. Once you realize and can accept the screen has always been perfect, then this induces this total creativity, which, of course, he said silence seems like nothing's happening. It's everything is happening. So for him, when he's sitting there, you think like nothing's happening. You say, no, everything is happening, meaning he's aware the screen is perfect and not trying to heal it, therefore allowing the flow of creativity to be induced as this all-ingingness, instead of this healingness, okay, that we're working on this healingness. How do we heal the wounds? How do we heal the hurt? How do we heal the sickness? How do we heal? How do we fix? Of course, well, that's a false hope belief system. So we're trying to motivate ourselves to heal, keep working on this, healing the screen, so to speak, healing pure awareness. That's like the screen that makes experiencing possible. It doesn't need to be healed at all. So what do you do with false hope? Well, in coming in contact with Ram Maharshi a couple of weeks ago in a dream, subconsciously, in other words, when I woke up, I was able to, what happened was there was this capacity to experience this blanket praise for all false hope scheming, God-centric and goddess-centric, and even transitions between the two. Just this blanket praising, because it reflects our creativity and freedom, doesn't it? It's all a reflection of our creativity and freedom, even though it's totally unnecessary and totally weird. And seems very limiting to us, it still is a reflection of our freedom and creativity. And we love that, and we intrinsically love that. But what we don't want to do is judge it. Okay, you always hear the spiritual coaches say, you know, judge not, lest ye be judged. Don't judge, got to get free of judgment. We say, well, how do you do that? It's by giving this blanket praising or blanket indifferencing. Okay, that's a Dzogchen story. Blanket indifferencing, or blanket praising, or if you want to use the words of Jesus in Journey Beyond Words, where he explicitly talks about this, he says blanket rejoicing. He says rejoice in all of your efforts of false hope equally. Just have a blanket rejoicing in everything. And this is what he's actually training. You know, this is what he wants us to do. That's what Ram Maharshi wants us to do. So when you see these people, you know, you're at peaceful mind, no thoughts. What it really means is no judgment. Thoughts are actually judgment. Okay, let's make this clear. When we say the thinking mind, we really mean the activity of judging. And what is judging? Judging means to say, well, this avenue of false hope is better than this avenue of false hope. This way of working on fixing an incapacitated screen is better than this way of fixing an incapacitated screen. But both of those are using the false premise that the screen's incapacitated. If you accept the screen is perfect and has always been so, then there isn't any need for any avenues of hope at all to fix it. And you realize that both are equally absurd. Equally absurd, but both reflect our creativity and freedom. So what you do is you realize it's completely absurd. False hope is totally absurd. It's a false premise, which is total absurdity. insisting that the screen is damaged when in fact it isn't, and saying that don't worry, we'll fix it, is absurdity. False hope is absurdity, actually. But with that absurdity is still our creativity and our freedom. So Jesus says, rejoice in your absurdity, but a blanket rejoicing, not a judgmental rejoicing. Rejoice equally in it all, equally in it all. This stops judgment. No more judgment. It means killing the mind. They say, kill the mind, kill the ego, stop, silence your thoughts. It really means silence your judgment. Now, in coming in contact with Ram Maharshi, I got a contact high took place. And it was effortless to just go right into this blanket, I call it blanket praise. Well, rejoice, it's a little different. Praise, rejoice, very, very close, or indifference is a sort of a neutral thing. Praise and rejoice is more of a positive thing. Rejoicing is a little stronger, and I sort of want to take the middle path between indifference and rejoicing, okay? There's like sort of three ways you can go about it. Indifference, rejoicing, or praise. So praise is more of a middle path, a way of looking at it, a way of responding to it. So with this feeling, it was just, there was no judgment taking place anymore. It wasn't any problem at all. I was still perfectly functional. It's just, there's this like sky-like feeling that didn't give rise to any judgmenting of this way of false hope is better than this way of false hope, you see. It was effortless. So that was due to a contact tie. I said, Ramana, I need this permanently. We need this permanently. So, you know, maybe more contact. Or, you know, something has to happen right now. Because this is indeed the answer. So when we're not judging, no false hope is arising, you see. So you're not swept away by any false hope movement. False hope always is active. It's very active, false hope. It's very active. Full of activity, because it says we must go down this road. This is the one that's going to work. And so this compels you into activism. And when you're compelled into activism of false hope, you are not able to see and experience that the perfection of the screen. It clouds this. You're totally focused on experiencing, ignoring the screen. This weird type of experiencing. Ignoring the screen, feeling that you need to, this experiencing has to fix the screen. So that the perfect screen is something in the future, never now. It's always in the future. False hope always puts a perfect screen in the future, always. So all of this is resonating from teaching that you've heard, coaching, I have to call it coaching, that we've already heard, but we're putting it into a better context at this point. This is what's happening. This is a clearer context than what we've had before. That's what we've been working on here. The work that's been taking place here has been one of putting it into a clearer context. So the spiritual coaches of the past were not wrong at all. It's just that we were looking at it through a very clear context. So we had trouble putting it into context. And they said, well, just do it. I said, just go ahead and do it and that'll work. And those who did, it did work for them. But in this time right now, you know, having a clearer context is extremely helpful, Because we're in a time of maximizing false hope right now to inaugurate a new cycle of false hope, a goddess-centric, female supremacist cycle of false hope, where we say, don't worry, we got love all figured out, and we'll use that. We'll use love, and of course, really it means sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and electronics to fix the screen, to fix the screen. bolt. So that just prevents you from realizing the screen is perfect right now and has always been perfect right now. It prevents us from experiencing that the screen is perfect. So what we're doing right now is we're speeding up. I had that near car accident and I said, how could I avoided that? Well, I slammed on the brakes, but I said, yeah, but that was really scary. However, if I had sped up and been ahead a little further down the road instead of slower, I wouldn't have been in that position at all. I would have been ahead of the situation. So what slowed me down? Looking at the sunset, looking at the beauty of nature, in other words, that slowed me down. Say, oh, isn't this lovely? Isn't this sunset more lovely than other loveliness or other stuff, right? So I kind of was like not going as fast as I usually go, actually. So if I had just gone my normal speed, I would have been ahead of the situation and never would have happened. So that was just pointing out, you know, the importance of getting ahead of the situation by going faster. So what happened last night at between 9:30 and 10 o'clock was just sitting in a chair, kind of bored, nothing to do. And suddenly I began considering the screen and appearance thing. I says, wait a minute, you know, they're mutually dependent. It's not one or the other. It's not, you can't have a screen without appearance. That's meaningless. And you certainly can't have appearance without a screen. That can't happen. So, but if you have both a screen and appearance, then each give meaning to the other, you see? So God the Father without God the Son, how can you be a father without, quote unquote, a son? Using that as a coverall term. How can you be a creator without a creation, you see? How can you be a father without a son? How can you be a son without a father, you see? Those two are mutually dependent. They're mutually dependent on one another. So I began to consider this, and then this led to a recognition, a clear recognition of you know, how we're trying to you know, find a way to be prior to the screen, prior to the great perfection, that we're the ones that induce the screen. We're the ones that induce the screen. But it didn't happen that way. It was the screen, it was the light that was there first that induces the creativity. So there was this huge, massive clarification that was just awesome. I was just shaken from it, you know, shaken from it. There's a new, you know, high watermark in honesty and clarity about context. I said, wow, okay, and then it's like, okay, well, let's not sweat the details at this point, because then you can easily lose sight of the basics if you sweat the details too much. So we're not going to worry about sweating the details too much right at this point. That would be a mistake. But we certainly have it, quote unquote, figured out. We got the basics really, really figured out to the next, you know, to the highest degree, really. We have it tremendously figured out here. And we're not going to say, well, prove it because by telling me all the details, because we could lose sight in the basic structure of it all by obsessing about details, you see. So what we need to do is simply accept the remedy at this point, which is this blanket praising. And once hindsight kicks in at some point, then the details will become obvious. The details become obvious usually in hindsight. You have to have the basics in place first, though. So there is some lessening of this anxiety taking place here. Because if you get caught up in hope, false hope, all hope is false hope. Reality doesn't have any hope. Hope for what? Hope that it functions properly? It intrinsically functions properly. There's no need for hope. There's just pure induced creativity experiencing on the screen of pure awareness. So there's no need for hope. So all hope is really false hope, kind of. Except, well, when there's false hope, then you have hope that you can get free of false hope. You can put it temporarily that way. But false hope demands actioning, because it's a rejection of what judgment says is not helpful. You see, it's both a grabbing and a rejection of. It's both of those. So when you go into this goddess-centric, female supremacist, false hope belief system, you're going to be grabbing that in booster of it, say, this is great, actively pushing to make this happen, which has been going on for 100 years here, but it's going to become extremely intense now. But you're also actively rejecting the other false hope path as useless and distracting and should be stamped out, which is the God-centric false hope path. So judgment is both affirmation and rejection. It's an affirmation and a rejection. But when you're rejecting the previous false hope belief system, a God-centric male supremacist false hope belief system, you are unable to have this blanket praising. And the clouds, so then therefore you're putting the perfect screen in the future. And you won't experience it now. And since you're not experiencing it now, this makes you feel insecure, which just makes false hope feel even more imperative. You see, it's a negative feedback loop. You see, we got to go faster, more activism, because it's in the future. We can see it. It's really, for sure, it's in the future. No, it's right now. So this false hope breeds activism. And activism is not only for something, it's also against something, always. It's dualistic. It's both for and against. There's no such thing as hope, activism, false hope that is purely positive. It's always both positive towards something and negative against something. And in doing that, you're still caught up in this imperfectioning belief in imperfection that needs to be healed, and not able to experience that the screen is perfect right now. It's in the future. And so that drives an idealism. You become obsessed, it becomes an idolatrous cult of future perfectionism, perfectioning, perfectioning, perfect. To perfect perfectivity-ing, future perfectivity-ing. But first, you have to get rid of that which is imperfect. You see? So the activism again is for reaching a future perfection by getting rid of imperfection. And the imperfection will be seen as the previous false hope belief system, the God-centered male supremacist, male figurehead, really it was, but male supremacist, if you want to use that term. And getting rid of that, stamping it out, destroying it. So activism, idealistic activism, false hope activism, is extremely destructive. We've seen this in like the Soviet revolution, Bolshevik revolution, stamping out the proletariat, the middle class, essentially the centrists, which was the proletariat, which was not the proletariat, it was the middle class. They sent them all to the gulags. They took all their property, all their farms, all their businesses, took away all private ownership of everything, and then sent them, to die in Siberia. And then they realized that still didn't work. So then the purges became more severe. Then they began purging those they felt weren't loyal enough to the to the no, weren't positive enough to this idealized future perfection. Soviet, Marxism is the belief that there's a way to reach a future perfection. That's false hope. And of course, in order to do that, you got to get rid of the stuff that's imperfect. So they began purging their own party, more and more and more purges, until the purges reached the very top of the party, and Stalin was like living in a prison, high security prison, to keep himself from being purged. So, that's what happens. So when you have this activism, false hope activism for a future perfectioning, you're going to have purging taking place. get rid of the negative, get rid of the stuff that represents is imperfection. Whereas the right path is to give blanket praise for all false hope schemes right now. You see, you can give blanket praise for all past, present, and future. Wow. My past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. Blanket praise for my past. Blanket praise for right now, my now, and blanket praise for my future. All of it. And that can be done right now. We can give blanket praise for past, present, and future right now. And we do that right now. This doesn't generate any judgment. It's saying no judgment, blanket praise. There's the final judgment. As Jesus taught, there's a final judgment you can make which will free you from your sins. And this is what's called the blanket praise is called final judgment. It's the one judgment that knocks out all other judgment so that no false hope arises. And with no false hope arising, which is putting, you know, action to bring about perfection by getting rid of something, with no false hope arising, we're able then to experience the present perfection of the screen of pure awareness. We're able to then become aware of it. We'll be able to experience it. We're willing. This enables the experiencing to arise. It spontaneously arises. And we say, oh, you know, where'd that come from? It's perfect. How can it be perfect? But it's perfect. Yeah, wait, what? I thought what did we do to make it perfect? We didn't do anything. We used the final judgment to make it perfect. Not to make it perfect, but to realize the intrinsic perfection of it. So the final judgment enables us to realize the intrinsic perfection of the screen. So, you know, what we're talking with here, you may be saying like, wow, this is really amazing, but I don't quite have the context figured out. Fortunately here, you know, the context is quite clear enough. But what's important is to realize, yeah, to get a feel like, you know, this is true. I get it. This does indeed to me. I realize this is true. Final judgment knocks out all false hope judgment, all judgments, all other judgments. No judgments are taking place in our just one equal praise to all possible judgments, you see. Equal praise to all possible judgments of this is good and this is bad. This is going towards perfectioning, this is taking us, this is still unhealed perfectioning, or, you know, sick perfectioning, sick screening, so to speak. It's sick. That's bad. We've got to get rid of that sickness, that badness. Equally, say all of that is just our play of creativity. Equally so. It's never not our play of creativity. It is our play of creativity and freedoming. That's our judgment. And there's nothing else causing it at all. It's coming from our creativity, our imagining. And that's praiseworthy because it is indeed our creativity that is being induced by the perfect screen. Also, you see, final judgment, equal praise for all past imagining, present imagining, and future imagining, no matter what it is. You see, then this calms us down. And there's no more activism taking place within us to seize the good and get rid of the bad. And when there's no more activism taking place in us, this allows our awareness to shift to the screen and to recognize it's perfect right now and always has been perfect. It just automatically happened just like that. So here we have the mechanics of it, you know, the mechanics of what has always been the prescription throughout history. We know, we see the context of it now. We see the context and we say, indeed, that is valid. That is what works. False hope activism doesn't work. Doesn't work. It just causes purges, which eventually flatten out into more centricism, which then enables, you know, some, doesn't always enable, just you go into sort of this flats and centricism of sort of mindless mindless consumerism and just, but there's always the capability to see through all of this, to see through all of this. There's always that capability. Centricism itself is kind of like you're in the blahs. You know, you've got the blahs. So it doesn't necessarily make it easy for you. You kind of like you're in a kind of a coma. So you have this false hope activism. You have then the terrible purges. That doesn't work. And then you go into this sort of flatlining centricism. Those are the cycles of this dream, false hope dream. So probably the best time to see all this is during transitional time. Last 100 years has been extremely excellent time, actually. Is you say, wait a minute, what's going on here? You know, we're losing our centricism, you know, or feel like we're being pressured into activism, but I'm used to centricism. Do I really want to go into activism? Doesn't feel quite right. You know, let me try it. Oh, I feel there's a lot of negativity to it. It's giving rise to positivity, but also equally negativity. And I feel I need to attack the negativity. And this doesn't feel like what I'm used to. So you start getting real nervous and anxious when you start going into, a transition between false hope schemes, or God-centric to goddess-centric. It becomes the age of anxiety. But in that age of anxiety, then you start saying, "Boy, I gotta get rid of this anxiety. What do I do?" And then you become willing to pay attention to truth. You say, "Levy, I'm kind of open-minded." You become more open-minded when you're in this time of transition. So this is what happened for me coming into this time. I came in like the perfect time of this age of transition to feel the anxiety of it, and to then say, "Hey, I got to look at this, really look at it, really carefully, with open-minded and determination. Otherwise, I feel I'm going to be swept away." lose my stability entirely here. It's terrible. So it was like really great opportunity, super great opportunity. So we look at this, just looking at this. This is our great opportunity now. This is great opportunity. Is to really nail it down now, to really get it nailed down and get ahead of this whole situation. And we've done that here. We've done it. It's a question now of accepting the fact we've done it. That's the next step, that we're accepting the fact we've done it. We've succeeded here. We've succeeded. But that in itself is a step to take, right? Is to not, don't doubt it. Just because you don't have the details all in place, don't doubt that you've got the gist of it clear. You've got it clear. Details, again, need some hindsight for all the details to fit in place. You need some hindsight. You can't get all the details ahead. You can't. You'll just flounder if you try to struggle with that. So that's why I have to stay away from certain situations that will demand details. The activists always want details. How do we get rid of, give me the details. Who do we, what heads do we need to bust is what they're really saying. What heads do we need to bust? And I'm saying, you don't need to bust any heads. Well, we need to know, otherwise, how can we reach this perfectioning that's in the future, like that. So it's a dangerous thing when you have it figured out, then the next combo, the world will demand details. And we just have to say, no details. Details arrive in hindsight. What's important is context. Is getting the context clear, the basic context, clarifying the basic context, and we've done that here. So now it's kind of, a waiting game to allow, the details, eventually will come in place, fit in place. What's important now is to allow this blanket praising to intervene. This is the intervention. This is the final judgment. So what has to happen now in this age of judgment is the final judgment has to intervene. The final judgment has to intervene. And we now recognize the context of this really better than it's ever been recognized, actually. But still, it holds that we need a hindsight for the details to fit in place. Just because we have clear recognition of context doesn't mean that we can speak of details yet. It doesn't mean that. It just means that even when we're in maximal stress to lose sight of context, we're not going to lose sight of it. It just means we're ahead of the situation, and this situation is the worst situation in history. So we needed extra clarity in order to get ahead of this situation, but it doesn't mean that we can put all the details in place at this point. And of course, the activists want details. What does details mean? They want lists. What is the first thing that happened when Banana Joe was the presumptive president, which means their scheme was working? The activist scheme for goddess-centric female supremacy was working. They said, okay, now the first thing they did, the activists, what they do? Lists. We need to make lists. We need to know every person that was pro-Trump, that was helped him in his administration. We need their names. We're listing their names. So what's going on right now behind the scene is this list making. You may not be aware of it yet, but you will in the near future. Is they're making lists. They have databases, of course, of everybody who's ever said anything pro-Trump, which means pro-God-centric or something, you know, like that. The previous false hope belief system. They're making lists, and you know, who are the worst people? Well, the people who supported him in the administration, everyone in the bureaucracy who supported Trump, they have lists of them. They're making lists right now. So first they purge the bureaucracy. Second, they purge the intellectuals, you see. So there's a whole hierarchy of purging that activists use, actually. The bureaucrats, the intellectual bureaucrats, the ideational bureaucrats, the ones that, you know, were ideationally supportive of it, they get purged first. And then the petty bureaucrats get purged, you know, second. And then the proletariat who were pro, you know, pro God-centric, then they get purged, you know, later, that kind of thing. So there's a whole succession of purges. They round up the most troublesome ones first, and then the roundups get bigger and bigger, wider net takes place. So immediately they said right away, okay, or we need to make lists now. That's what the first thing you heard was, like, we need to list everybody in the administration that was ideationally driving this whole previous administration, and we're going to have repercussions on them. That's the first thing they did. So you know exactly what's taking place. This has happened in the Soviet Union, Communist China. Same thing. It always takes place. That's what activism does. It has to destroy the previous hope, false hope. So everybody can say, we got no choice. This is the only game in town. You see, false hope has to seem like it's the only game in town. So you say, well, I got to do this. So they want to get rid of the previous false hope scheme as fast as possible. As fast as possible. So immediately, that's, you could hear that the radicals immediately said, okay, list time. Let's get on it. And they're on it. They're on it right as we speak. They're on it. Now, we're not on the list here. I got assurance from the great perfection. I asked, if you want me to go forward, you got to assure me that I'm not going to, you know, be on the head-busting list. And I got the assurance. Says, don't worry. It won't work that way. Because here, it's a very different thing. We're into final judgment, the last judgment, that all judgments are equally praiseworthy, you see. Equally praiseworthy as a reflection of our creativity and freedoming. But only in that context are they praiseworthy. But they are praiseworthy in that context. So we're not ideologically driven at all. We're final judgment driven. Last judgment, final judgment driven. Equal praising. So this puts us, you know, off the radar, so to speak, of the activists. We're not on their radar, actually. And won't be on their radar. They'll just say, you know, this is kooks. It's not important. It's not important right now. It's not important. Not going to waste our effort on these idiots. These are like, you know, total idiots. Now, when everybody goes crazy, those that are sane are going to seem crazy. Okay, keep this in mind. So we have a situation coming up in the world starting January 6th where everybody in the world, 100% minus, is going to go crazy. They're going to become crazed, is a better way to put it. They're going to become crazed. But that's what I mean by crazy. It is mean an action of crazed. If someone's crazy, but they're not doing anything, you know, people say, well, but if they're taking action, then they're crazed. You know, they say they're crazy because they're taking action now. So you get a situation in the world where it's going to become crazed. But those who don't become crazed at all, who are just sitting blanket praising of all judgmenting, wow. They're going to say, we're crazy. They say, hey, those guys are just crazy. You know, they're crazy, but they're harmless crazy. Now they're harmless crazy. Nothing to worry about here. Nothing to worry about here. So we're, you know, harmless crazy here. We're harmless crazies. They'll laugh. Say, look at those crazies. You know, that's funny. It's comic relief, you know. Comic relief for them, actually. Comic relief. Comic relief. So this is, you know, how we'll have to look at it, really. Because again, when everyone goes crazy, goes into a crazed condition, those who don't will seem like they're crazy. This is what happens. So we have to kind of flow with that whole thing. We have to kind of embrace it. You know, we have to embrace it that people will think we're kooky. Yeah, kooky, but not dangerous kooky, really. Just kind of amusing kooky, you know. Yeah, those kooky, the kooky ones, you know. Those are kooks, yeah. Kooky, but kind of funny, you know, kind of funny. But, you know, inside they're saying, ah, thank you. You know, thank you. At least I feel, you know, that there is a way. Maybe there is a way. So I'm going to laugh about it for now. I'm going to laugh about it. For now, it's sort of laughable, meaning maybe. When you're in a maybe phase, early maybe phase, truth is kind of laughable. It's kind of kooky laughable. But you're not totally rejecting it. You're kind of laughing at it. And eventually you start laughing with it. You see, first you laugh at it, and then you laugh with it. And then you start realizing, hey, this is it. This is it. So first laughing at it, then with it, then this is it. And no more laughter. Then you realize, wow, this is it. Let's get serious about this. So that's what's coming. That's what's coming. You know, I'm trying to adjust to that. I'm sort of going to use a persona, you know, a persona that just embraces people thinking that we're a little kooky. You know, those poor folks, they're a little crazy. They don't understand what's going on. They're not able to get with it, you know. They're not able to get with the program, you know, the activist program. But, you know, they're not really troublemakers, really. They're just, you know, they're just spaced out, you know. They're just spaced out kooks. Must be on drugs or something, you know. Yeah. So that's how we're seeing it here. This is a way forward, you know. You cannot insist that people take you seriously at this point. They're not going to take you seriously, but they can at least kind of take you humorously. It's like, who is this kook? This is a pretty funny funny guy, actually. Like, what? You know, this is funny. That's funny. That's funny. That's all I can say about that. It's funny. Court jester, you know, well, I got to have court jesters. There's always court jesters in all false hope cycles where you're tolerated, you know, it's okay. You give kind of a little bit of humorous relief to the situation. So we'll be the court jesters, you know, we'll be the court jesters, so to speak. I remember playing golf with someone a long time ago. Crazy guy. He's the funniest guy I've ever met in my life. He was this trick shot artist and a jokester and was just constantly cutting jokes and having a blast out there. And he was from Las Vegas. He was a Las Vegas hustler. He made his money hustling golf on the golf course by saying, I bet I can do this. You want to bet I can't? And he is doing crazy stuff. You know, hitting left-handed, throwing the ball in there, hitting it. He was doing stuff we'd never, ever seen before. And it was just like, what? But he was just laughing it up, and he was the funniest person I've ever met. It was unbelievable how hilarious he was and how funny it was to be with. You know, we were just kids, so we didn't bet anything, but he just said, hey, kids, you know, what do you think about this? Can I do this? And we said, no. And he did it. We'd say, what? He was a blast. We just thought he's a kook. This guy's a kook. But then later on, I started thinking about it. And I said, this guy's not a kook. This guy's like unbelievably talented. Unbelievably talented. But the only way that he can really fit in is to pretend to be kind of a kook, you know. This guy's so good. You know, he can do it backwards, you know. He can do it left-handed. I mean, he can do it. I didn't even know what he was doing. It's hard to remember what he was doing, but it was like, we were just like shaking our heads and like, this guy's just completely kooky. But no, he was like a genius golfer, is what he really was. He's just having fun. You know, you're with the kids. You're the kids. They don't understand how to play the game yet. They don't understand. So, you know, let's just kind of show them some fun. Let them laugh. Have some laughs. But it rubbed off on me. I said, wow, that it's possible to be so good that you can do this stuff. I said, that wasn't luck. You know, this was like just some kind of supreme talent that this man had. Supreme talent. But if he showed the supreme talent off, we would have been... awed too much. We'd be put in awe. You know, so he showed it off in a kooky way. You know, like, what was he doing? You know, it's like, you know, let me play a putter from 70 yards. Think I can, you know, knock it on the green with the putter? Like, what? Boom, he knocks it on the green. He could do anything with any club, you know. So he just made it like a game. We were able to laugh, and it was a game. But if he played just like normal golf, he would have just, you know, utterly trounced the course, you know. And we would just been like, uh-oh, this guy's some kind of pro, you know. We can't play with pros, you know. This guy's too good, you know. Scared, would have scared us. So he just, instead, he just said, hey, you know, you think I can do this? You know, you guys believe I can do this? We'd say, no way, you can't, nobody can do this, you know. And then he'd do it. We'd say, whoa, that was cool. And so he made it like kind of cool. So he wasn't into scoring low, which would have like, intimidated us. He was just into doing cool stuff. And so we liked it. We said, that's really cool, man. We had a blast with this guy. And then he had a blast with us too. Because we were willing, you know, to play along with it, you know. But wow, what a lesson that was. I don't know, who was this? Was this like Jesus or something? I don't know. Just appearing? Could have been, you know. It could have been just a holographic appearance thing, actually. Because the guy was out of this world. What he could do. And the cover story, well, I'm a Las Vegas hustler, you know, and stuff. I said, oh, okay, yeah, it makes sense now. But I don't know, maybe it was just a holographic, it could have been just a hologram. Possible. Because I've never seen anybody since be able to play like that. Greatest player I've ever seen, even better than Tiger Woods. You know, Tiger Woods could do a lot of stuff with a golf ball. This guy could do just anything. Hey, kids, think I can do this? Let me see. Let's see what happens. Oh, I did it. Wow. Maybe it was a hologram. Maybe we'll find out that there have been holograms appearing throughout history, you know? Maybe Papa Sama was a hologram. Yeah. Maybe Jesus was a hologram. Yeah. Maybe we've been visited by holograms. Very possible, isn't it? Very possible. he presented in a cool, kind of kooky way that people said, wow, that's cool. Maybe Jesus said, hey, kids, think I can walk on water? You know, they said, nah, no way, Jesus. And they walk and they said, wow, that's cool. Hey, kids, think I can multiply bread and fish? And said, ah, no way, Jesus. And they did it. And they say, holy cow, you know, that's cool. That's amazing. Hey, kids, think I can heal this leper? And then, nah, nobody can heal that. Boom, you know, it's like, wow. Of course, what Jesus just did was the lepers had faith that Jesus telling them that reality is perfect. The screen is perfect. Hey, leper, the screen is perfect. Just trust me. I know for a fact this is so. And you don't need to heal the screen. So you don't need sickness to try to practice on healing the screen or making it seem like the screen is in the process of being fixed, because this little imperfection of this individual leprosy is being fixed. That means a little pixel on the screen is being fixed. You don't need to fix that little pixel. You don't need to do it. And the leper would say, oh, I believe in Jesus. And so then the illness, leprosy just departed. It's all imaginary. It's all, the whole universe is just holographic, imaginary. It's imaginary, actually. So the leprosy just vanished. Just vanished. It wasn't fixed or cured or anything. It just vanished, just departed. No more need for it. No more need for it. That's what actually took place. So this video may seem kind of kooky to all of you, right? It's like, what in the world is going on? It's this like, wow. But you can also say, this video is pretty cool. It's like really cool. It's like, wow. You know, how does this all fit together? You know, but it's doable. It is possible to like see it this way, isn't it? I can hear this. I'm hearing it, so it is possible. But say, man, I don't know if I could fit it together like that. You know, I don't know if I could do that, but it is possible, isn't it? It certainly is. It certainly is. When you get the context, when you start seeing the context, then you say, oh my goodness, yeah. Wow. So we'll see how it goes. Either it'll be kooky or it'll be just like reclusive. You know, one of the two. I'm not sure which one's going to happen. One of the people I most admire is someone who's really kooky. They don't care in the slightest bit what anyone thinks of them, and then nobody bothers them because they think, well, this guy's a bit kooky, just sort of kooky. So we're not going to even bother with him. It's like, oh, he's poor, mentally deranged, mentally retarded, but he's harmless. He's just a harmless, kooky guy, so it's okay. We're not going to get upset with him. Yeah. I said, wow, what an ability that is. And out of the blue, he just contacted me a couple days ago. Haven't heard from him for like 10 years or so, you know, or a long time, maybe 7, 8 years. It's been a long time. He just said, hey, you know, hi, you know, I'm going to start making videos again this October. I said, cool, wow, that's something to look forward to. I said, your video is the greatest videos I've ever watched, no question about it, because he's simply able to put himself in the midst of people's lives and just tape it as it's happening, you know, without people getting angry at him. Nobody else could do this. You can't do this. They would feel it's, you're imposing upon their privacy and their personal lives and their lives. But he just doesn't even ask permission. He just does it. And I'm saying, what? And the people don't mind. They just laugh at him. It's just, okay. You know, crazy. They go, crazy kook, you know. Crazy European, just a kook. It's okay. They just laugh at him. Oh, this guy's a kook. No problem. And he then gives you this view of life as it actually is taking place that you never get otherwise. It's so amazing. And I tried to popularize his videos. Nobody nobody got it, you know, really. I really tried to really say, hey, this guy's videos, you know, you need to need to watch this. It's possible. This is possible to do. And he did it over and over and over again. Man, you know, he'd stop like on a street scene in Bangladesh, construction going on. And he'd get out of his rickshaw and then he'd just wander into the construction site where all these workers are working. And he'd just start videotaping. He didn't ask permission from the foreman or anybody else. And people would come up and say, hey, yeah, what are you doing? And he'd just keep taping them. What are you doing? What are you doing? You know, video. They say, oh, wow. You know, but they didn't kick him out. They just said, you know, this guy's a cuckoo, whatever. I'm busy, so I'm not going to worry about it, whatever. It's unbelievable. And then he would tape what every person and talk to them, construct what they're doing as they're working. Just they come up to workers and videotape them, and work. And he didn't bother them. They kept working. And then you feel like you're like virtual reality. You were immersed in this. You were actually immersed in this. It was the greatest art I've ever experienced. And he just laughs. No, I'm just a kook, he says. And I said, nah, you're like the ultimate artist, actually. And he contacted me and said, I'm going to do some more taping. I said, wow, that's fantastic. And I said, you got the greatest videos ever. He goes, oh, no, you're praising me too much. And I said, no. He said, I'm just a kook, that's all. And I said, no, I understand what you are. You're like a virtual realityist, like awareness, pure awareness, just being there, seeing everything. You know, and people just say, oh, yeah, it's okay. Yeah, this guy's just a kook. Wow. He's ahead of the rest of us. But you would never notice it. He just acts like a kook, you know. But he's got it down perfectly. I mean, I just think he's just, you know, the most amazing person in the world, really. And I kind of forgot him. He stopped doing it. He worked on like simulations, truck simulations and plane simulators and stuff. That's what he's been doing. I don't know why, but he's been doing it. Amazing simulations. And now he said, I'm going to go back to taping now. It's like, oh, wow. That's amazing. I tried doing this. Couldn't do it. I was too self-conscious. Like, what they might say about me. I couldn't do it. It's like the highest skill there is. It is still. He did it flawlessly. Flawlessly. And people get irritated a little bit, but he never responded to the irritation. And I just say, oh, this guy he's crazy. But he's harmless. Okay. Not on a problem. Crazy, harmless, whatever. I'm going to go on with my life. And then he'd keep taping everything. He's like the only foreigner in Bangladesh. And he's in the market, in this incredible marketplace. They're having stuff you've never seen before in your life. And he's just immersing himself in this and taping it all as it's happening and stuff. And nobody's, you know, everybody's just being normal and natural. And he's capturing that. It's so uncontrived. You know, it's flawless. It's fantastic. Greatest videos ever. And maybe I'll tell you of his channel. Maybe we'll see how it goes. But this points out, you know, the principle that this is possible to be helpful here. You know, people just write you off as, well, this is just a court gesture, this poor kook. I'm not so great at that. That's what I'm saying. Being a recluse, you know, it may be better. You know, really. We'll see. But those are kind of the two paths that can be taken. So, a lot to consider here. A lot to consider here. Indeed. And you realize, you know, maybe you're having anxiety right now. Well, join the club, you know. But this should be helping with your anxiety, saying, hey, wait a minute. There is a perspective here. Maybe there is something that I can enjoy. Just like I enjoy those videos, maybe I'll be able to help out, you know, some in the world by enjoying these videos or some sort of videos or some sort of video experience or some experiencing where you say, that is so cool. Yeah, that's it. And it's something conveys something to you that's so great, you don't you just feel like you don't need to be paying attention to the rest of the world at all. There's something going on here that is like so sublime, you can't really put your finger on it, you know? But it is happening. Of course, that's the final judgment, blanket praising on all judgmenting. Wow. Experiencing the screen, the perfectioning, the present perfectioning of the screen. Wow. Wow. Okay. So we're still on target. I feel a little less anxious. If you're feeling anxiety, okay, you know, pay attention here. Just get the like a breeze. You get the gist of it. Say, wow, this is extremely amazing, actually, to hear this. Extremely amazing. So there are a lot of you watching the videos, less viewers, but they're viewing for more time. That means you're getting it. There's some that are getting it and realize, hey, this is an experience. This is not a, this is an experience. This isn't some didactic teaching. This is some sort of experience, like a concert that we're experiencing here. Take it that way. Like this is just like some kind of concert. Wow. And take it like that. This is just wow. This is just wow. You know, it's like some virtual reality concert that you're experiencing. Take it that way. Take it that way. You have to shift. You know, what is this? It's not some teacher teaching you something. This is like a virtual reality concert, a holographic virtual reality concert or something. It's just like, wow.